In your, again, in the essay, A Life of Learning, you mention, you say that, that you felt a great sort of traumatic and personal embarrassment about the depression that you've carried with you in your life. Can you tell me, describe what that feeling is and what you took away from it and how it's affected your life, how the depression has affected your life?
Well, I suppose that the first real trauma of the depression came from the fact that my father was a lawyer in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and had a clientele which was either all black or nearly all black. And they were, while he was a popular lawyer with lots of business, they were unable to pay him because they were unemployed for the most part. Well, certainly they didn't have any substantial attorney's fees to offer for the services which he performed. And so I began to see my father as really as what I thought was a poor businessman. We don't have much, why don't we? He's busy all the time. These people aren't paying him. And one of the reasons I wanted to become a lawyer and to go back and practice law with my father was to make him a success. That is, that I would know how to get the money out of these people. And in that way, he would be fulfilled in a way that I thought he deserved to be. I didn't realize the depth of the depression. And I don't think I realized it until I got in college. I graduated from Booker T. Washington High School when I was 16 and went on to Fisk when I was still 16. And during that first year, I worked, but that didn't bother me. And I realized that I had to work in order to help with my fees and so forth. But then at the end of that year, that first year in college, my brother, who had graduated from Fisk 2 years before and who was now teaching in back in Tulsa County, came for my sister and me. We were both freshmen together. We were just 13 months apart. Came for my sister and me in my father's automobile. That didn't strike me as odd, although I later learned that he came for me so that he could transport us both back to Tulsa for less than the railroad fare for two people would be. But when we got to Tulsa, we didn't go in the direction that I knew our home was. And instead he turned down another street and finally got to a street where I knew that my father had built a small four-family flat or apartment. And he stopped in front of this place. And I said, "What are you stopping for?" He said, "This is where we live." My father had lost our home. And when he had the option of losing the home or losing that piece of property, part of which was income property, he decided to give up the home, live in part of that apartment building, and rent out the rest of it. It is impossible for me to tell you what a remarkable impact that had on me in the matter of depressing me and of disappointing me and of feeling really homeless. And it caused me to have an attitude toward money, toward thrift, and that sort of thing, which I don't believe I would have had otherwise. And although I had no way of asserting it then, I was determined that I would remain, solvent for the remainder of my life, if I possibly could. That explains my attitude toward credit cards in this year. It explains my feeling that if I can't afford to purchase something, I shouldn't purchase it. It explains my desperate attempt in every instance where I have purchased a home to pay for it as rapidly as possible so that I won't be evicted. This notion of being evicted was always with me, you see. And I never shall forget when we were purchasing our home in Chicago. Whenever I got in extra money, I would double up the payments. And the great day of freedom came when I made the last payment on that house, you see.
How old were you, going back again to your childhood, back to the memoir, how old were you when you first, as a child or whenever you were, how old were you when you first saw a white school? I assume you went to black schools. When you first saw a white school and you saw the difference of where you went to school and what they did, and what was your reaction?
Well, you see, I grew up in an all-black town until I was 10 years old. And obviously I didn't see a white school in that period of time. We would go to a small town, Shakota, to shop. Or we would go to Muskogee, where I had my first encounter with an eye specialist when I was 5 years old. I began to wear glasses. But I don't remember seeing any white schools at that time. It was after I went to Tulsa when I was 10 years old that I saw the difference between Booker T. Washington High School, where I went. It was a comprehensive school. It's called them high school because it was from elementary, it was K through 12. And that, the difference between that school and Central High, which was the white school, was almost the difference between night and day. And I saw Central High shortly after I moved to Tulsa, so that I would say I was 10 or 11 at the time that I saw that white children had certain kinds of facilities for education, and blacks had certain other quite inferior kinds of facilities for their education.
Thank you. Can you cut for a second, Michael?
Sure.
Okay, I'll tell you about that first incident.
When I went to Nashville as a freshman to attend Fisk University in 1931, I had a searing racial experience, which remained with me for the rest of my life. And that was that when I went into the town, the city of Nashville, on the streetcar and did some shopping, when I got ready to return to the campus, I went to the transfer station where one got changed his money, one got a ticket, and I had only a $20 bill, and I said to the ticket, the man in the ticket window, that I'm sorry, I have only a $20 bill. You can give it back to me. You can give me change in ones or whatever. And he says, listen, no nigger is going to ever tell me how to make change. Now you remember that. And with that, he gave me the 19 plus dollars in nickels and dimes. And I walked away from there, realizing that this that I would have to avoid as much as possible any brushes or contacts with people like that one. And so it certainly did have a lot to do with my going into town as infrequently as I possibly could, because I wanted to avoid him and all people like him.
Great, thanks. Good. Great. So what happened to, his name is Cordy Cheek, isn't it?
When I was a senior at Fisk and was president of the student government there, a young teenager living in a home very near the campus, owned by Fisk University, the house was, he was not connected with Fisk himself, was riding his bicycle and struck a white child. Did not kill the child, but struck the white child, and the town became enraged that this would happen. And he was taken, literally taken away from his house one day by a mob and taken to the edge of the city and lynched. When word got back that that had happened, the campus was ablaze with fury. Not only that a black child had been lynched for no good reason at all, but that he had been taken really from the Fisk campus, as it were. And the result was that the students were up in arms and immediately began to demand that there be some kind of expression of resentment and outrage at this travesty.
Okay, we better cut for a second because I think you're...
One of the things that the students did immediately was to hold a mass meeting, at which time they discussed what they should do. Interestingly enough, at that mass meeting, Mrs. James Weldon Johnson was present and suggested that we ought to do what they did in 1917, that is, to protest lynching, namely to have a march, a silent protest parade. In the case of 1917, it was down Fifth Avenue, but now down through downtown Nashville. That was knocked around, but it was discarded. But we did decide that we would present a petition to the President of the United States, who was coming through Nashville, visiting Fisk University, on his way to Warm Springs, Georgia, in November 1934. So, as president of the student government, I began to get this petition together. It disturbed the president of Fisk University that we would do this to the guest of the university, namely the president of the United States. And so he persuaded us to desist from that and assured us that if we did not try to present the president with a petition when he was on Fisk campus, then he would see to it that we got a chance to visit the president at Warm Springs, Georgia, and present him with a petition there asking him to speak out against lynching and asking him to support an anti-lynching bill. We bought this suggestion, and as a result, several of us went to Atlanta, Georgia, where we were to await word when we could go to Warm Springs, Georgia. That word never came, and I think the contact probably was never made with the president.
Great, thanks. In your memoirs, again, we talked about this earlier, the incident in Cambridge at Harvard at the Henry Adams Club.
Oh,
this was your first contact. You called it the most traumatic, your most traumatic social experience at Harvard. Can you describe what that was and how that came about and how it affected you?
The most traumatic social experience that I had during my years of graduate study at Harvard University came really in the toward the end of the first year of my graduate work. I was a member of the Henry Adams Club, the Club of Students of American History, and we were getting ready to elect offices for the following year. I was placed on the nominating committee. I suppose that would take care of me, since one didn't nominate anyone from the nominating committee. But then when the question arose, whom should we have for president? A certain brilliant, extraordinary outstanding student was suggested by me. I said, it's obvious whom we should have, and I named him. And the members of the committee looked at each other. And then one of them said that, well, to be sure, he does not have all of the objectionable characteristics of Jews, but he's a Jew. Well, I'd never experienced anything even resembling or suggesting that. I did not know what they were talking about. I'd never thought of this person as Jewish, and if I had, I wouldn't have known what that meant, except that he perhaps was belonged to a religion that was Jewish. So all of these overtones of objectionable characteristics over simply flew in the face of me, and I took it personally because I had made the judgment that this was the outstanding student at Harvard in American history, and that he deserved this recognition, and why shouldn't he be given it? And I wrestled with that. I think I wrestled with that so much within myself, trying merely to understand what they were talking about, that I really lost track of the main problem, namely, of getting a president for the Henry Adams Club. I remember that for the rest of my life. I'd like to say that those so-and-so's, those others, some of them didn't ever get through with their graduate work either.
From a personal standpoint, what kinds of...
Tulsa was one of the most segregated cities that one can even imagine. Not only were blacks and whites separated, but institution-wise, from every conceivable way, not only the churches, not only the schools, but also the entertainment was entirely separate. In most cities, such as Nashville, for example, you would have segregated parts of a movie house, you see. Blacks could go in, up into the gallery or over on one side, but not in Tulsa. You didn't go to the same movie houses. So there were two motion picture houses that blacks attended in the black part of town that whites did not go to. One was owned, by the way, by a white man. The other was owned by a black man. Not only did we see movies at these theaters, but we saw live shows, vaudeville shows, people being brought in, one for one night stands and that sort of thing, with Nicholas Brothers and Whitman Sisters and what and all the rest of it. It was really quite something. They did not play in Tulsa at the white places. They simply went on through. One had the feeling, as one looked at these shows, one had the feeling that these people were really very good. They were talented. They were stars, and we liked that. The motion pictures that we saw were all of them that I can remember, motion pictures of whites, primarily whites. There might be a black character here and there in some servile role, but we didn't see, I didn't see a motion picture made by or for blacks when I was growing up at all. There was, of course, the motion picture industry was not interested in that. And so, aside from a few black motion picture producers about whom I was to hear later, aside from them, there simply was not the opportunity. So that we grew up going to the movies, seeing cowboy shows and the like, and seeing these live vaudeville and musical shows. That's what the entertainment was.
So the white people, though, what would they see? What image, if any, would they have of black people at that time? Again, think about the 30s.
I would suppose that their image was enlarged from these minor roles that blacks had. I can remember very well, for example, being in downtown Tulsa, white Tulsa, and being asked by some white man, said, "I'll give you a quarter if you'll dance," you see. I ignored him. I just didn't even stop to talk with him about it, because I simply was not of the type. But he must have got that impression from somewhere, some experience, either on the silver screen, so to speak, or in his personal experiences. He thought blacks were entertainers, that all blacks could entertain, all blacks could dance, I suppose, he thought. And thus he would approach me in that sort. I suppose that's the best I can envision of what they experienced.
We just ran out of film. We got good. But the strategy for his desegregation strategy. At least at that point in the mid 30s, what his strategy was to kind of break down desegregation in education.
Mm-hmm. When I first met Charles Houston, he was traveling through the South to do several things. One was to find clients, that is, to find black parents who were willing to join in legal action against segregated education. That was one thing he was doing. Another thing he was doing was to try to get the general public, general African-American public, to understand the importance of legal action, resorting to the courts to redress their grievances. And I think that another thing he was doing was to try to increase the awareness of blacks of the importance of voting and of getting out the vote in places where they could vote and contesting the discrimination in places where they could not vote. So when he came to Fisk University in my junior year, that would be 33, 34. He and Andrew Ransom and others had been traveling on these various missions. And he spoke at Fisk. And that's the first time I heard him talk about the importance of legal action to challenge the segregated laws themselves, to get litigants who were willing to stand up and say that they were discriminated against, and to insist upon equality, and gradually to develop the notion that equality meant desegregation. I think, though, that the refinement of that position came with Thurgood Marshall and not with Houston, but the whole approach of legal action for civil rights was the Houston approach, and a man who was deeply dedicated to it, deeply committed, who really literally gave his life for this cause.
Do you need to do that now?
No, I'll.
So, if you will first tell us about your reaction to the Murray versus Maryland and that victory, but then what its ramifications.
Well, the victory of Murray against the University of Maryland was, of course, a very immediate concern to me because I was a graduate student myself and was interested in not in going to professional school. I had given up the law, the study of the law, but history was my thing then. But it didn't, although we appreciated very much the fact that this was a breakthrough, we also understood that it was not to be generalized. That is beyond Maryland, for after all, I was a citizen, I guess you can call it that, of a segregated state. And there was no impact of that decision on the state of Oklahoma, which would still reject me from the University of Oklahoma Graduate School and would instead pay my tuition at Harvard University if I got up there and was admitted and made the grades and sent them to the state of Oklahoma, then they would pay a fraction of my tuition. And it remained like that until the late 40s or very early 50s.
Great. Okay, so let's try it again with Donald Gaines Murray against Maryland, but what kind of ramification it did or didn't have for you?
Of course, when the decision was handed down in Gaines Murray against the University of Maryland, I personally was very interested in it because, after all, that was the year that I was going to graduate school, not to professional school, to be sure, but I was interested in going to graduate school. I'm not at all certain, though, that the impact of that decision was widespread or was widely appreciated, for, after all, how many blacks would be interested in going to law school, and how could you generalize that decision so that it would apply to graduate students and undergraduate students? It simply did not play in that way. As for me, a student at the at Harvard University from Oklahoma, I got no benefit from the Gaines decision. As a matter of fact, if anything, Oklahoma decided to move in the other direction, so that what I got was I was permitted by Harvard University to come there to study and to perform. If I was successful in that, then I would notify the state of Oklahoma, which in turn would give me a fraction of the tuition that I had paid months before, you see. So that there wasn't really very much general benefit that came out of that decision, and would not be really until the late 40s and early 50s that that students generally would benefit from Supreme Court decisions in higher education.
Great, cut.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. There have been people who have said that blacks were not interested in international affairs. I won't argue the point generally, but I will say that they were interested in the conflict between Ethiopia and Italy. They were very much distressed that that Mussolini would invade Ethiopia and would undertake to subjugate it, as he undertook to do in the 1930s. And I would argue that blacks followed that. I know I did, but I'm not referring merely to me. I know that blacks of various levels of education and of sensitivity with respect to international affairs generally were quite anxious to keep up with the score, if nothing else. What's the score between the United, between Mussolini and Ethiopia? And of course, the Emperor Haile Selassie became a great hero in the black community in the United States at that time because of his stand against Mussolini. I don't believe that there were large numbers of blacks who understood the history of the whole conflict that went all the way back to Menelik, Emperor Menelik, in the late 19th century and his conflicts with Europe. But putting that aside, they certainly were aware of it. And you read the newspapers in this period, the black press keeps up with this great care. We've had students who write dissertations on the subject, and there's no question but that the black press was interested, and through the black press, the black public generally was interested in the conflict.
Not to belabor the obvious, but for, you know, the students, the young people who are going to do it, why did black Americans take this so personally?
Well, here was a great European power undertaking to oppress one of the few black nations in the world. After all, this is most of Africa was gone. That is, was gone into the colonial orbit. You see, and only a few places, and Ethiopia was one of them, was left where there was an independent country with a ruler that was black, and it was a source of considerable pride to blacks that here was at least one black nation with a black leader. And I think that there was no question but that they wanted Ethiopia to win. and they were rooting for the emperor all the way.
Great. Now, do you think... Sorry, you running out?
Yes, ran out.
I run out of my element.
Okay. We ready? So
I think there was a certain respect in this country for fascism. I'm not referring to the kind of admiration that various groups like Father Coughlin would inspire, but I'm talking about the general impression that Americans seem to have had in the 1930s, that fascism was effective, efficient, was orderly, and that had objectives that could be admired, such as building efficient, well-run factories, making the railroads run on time, as so many people would say at that time. At a time when our own economy was floundering and uncertain, and at a time when we did not seem to know how we were going to get out of our own very difficult dilemmas, that we could see that there was someone who was working through this problem. And so I think that in that way, Mussolini and fascism generally inspired some admiration and attention in this country.
Okay. Now, Joe Lewis. Why do you think Joe Lewis was so important to his people? He was a boxer. I mean, he wasn't a scientist. He wasn't a great artist. He was a boxer. What was it about Joe Lewis that had such great appeal to people?
Well, of course, he was sure the greatest boxer of his time, and I think people always admire greatness, regardless of what it's in. Don't forget that blacks have had a champion once, and Jack Johnson, and he was greatly admired. And blacks always seemed to feel that Johnson was brought down by white people, deliberately brought down by white people. So here is the brown bomber, as they called Joe Louis, who inspired pride. He was modest, he was unassuming, he was highly skilled in his area, and that was to be admired. And he was a kind of vindication of Johnson and of black people. And therefore, they greatly admired him. Now, he came to be admired even more when he became something of a symbol of not only of the greatness of black people, but of this country, in the two bouts with Max Schmeling. And he seemed to have personified the struggle of this country against Nazism. And when he lost the first fight, that sent this country and certainly black people into the doldrums from which they would never seem to recover until he won the second fight. And with that, the nation was vindicated, blacks were vindicated, Nazism was put down, and it seemed that they would live happily ever after.
Great. Thank you. Cut for a second, please. Good. So we'll go 1 second when Michael's ready to talk about Jesse. Okay.
It's very interesting that after Max Schmeling won the first fight with Joe Louis, and blacks following that were very much distressed and humiliated. They didn't have to wait long for a real triumph. And that was when Jesse Owens went to Berlin for the Olympics, where he won several gold medals, and to the consternation of Hitler and to the delight of Americans, and particularly African Americans. And if anything, the fact that Hitler could not bear the notion of a black man winning these medals, and who, before the entire world, gave him something of a cold shoulder, that certainly made black Americans realize that this Aryanism was the very worst kind of racism, and that Hitler had sort of been rubbed in the face by Owens and by the victory of Owens.
Great, that's wonderful. Thank you. Since we're talking about Nazism and the Aryanism, was there concern in the black community for what was going on with the Jews in Europe? Did that evolve? Was there at some point in which, I mean, were African Americans aware in their own right, or did they have too many troubles of their own?
I actually am not at all certain about that. It's very difficult, you see.
And yet still, somehow FDR came on.
But
came
you see, they that. Didn't see all that there. They didn't see
okay.
it there.
Well, let's talk about FDR and his relationship to the, you know, the black, you know, population, community. Rolling, Steve. Okay.
Franklin D. Roosevelt inspired large numbers of blacks. I think in part because he was handicapped himself. And although that was not publicized as much as it might have been, blacks knew that he was a victim of polio, that he couldn't walk, and that he had overcome these handicaps. That was one thing. Another thing is that in contrast to the inactivity of, say, a Herbert Hoover, or an indifference of a Calvin Coolidge, this man was up and at him. He hit the ground rolling, so to speak, And that was inspiring, that he had something to say, he had a purpose, he had a message, he had a program. And it seemed that was better than the inertia that preceded him. Now, he did a few things that one might call cosmetic in impressing blacks that he was on their side. He had what we later call the black cabinet, that is, a number of blacks who were advisors to him. And these people, while really not in policy positions, nevertheless were names and were referred to as people of some considerable weight in the government. And that, I think, was magnified considerably in the black community. And even though it might not have been very much, it was more than blacks had ever had in the executive part of the government. So the people like like Weaver, Robert Weaver, Mrs. Mary McLeod Bethune, William J. Tompkins, others, they were greatly admired in the black community because it seemed that they were just going in and out of the White House and having all this influence. Well, to be sure, they did not have very much influence. I think that's quite clear now. And the influence they had, they might have had through Mrs. Roosevelt more than through the president himself. Meanwhile, the policies of the New Deal were not terribly liberal when it came to race. Surely the housing program maintained the standards of segregation, principles of segregation that prevailed before Roosevelt. The Tennessee Valley Authority, this remarkably revolutionary program that brought the South up in many ways, and it gave it industry and recreation and electrification and so forth. Policies with respect to blacks were very, very poor. And nothing was significantly changed in the relationships of people or in the employment opportunities and that sort of thing from what they had been before the New Deal. But there was a kind of, I hate to say it, a kind of trickle-down effect, after all, that if the economy was being raised generally, then blacks were benefiting somewhat. I think that they benefited, for example, in the Farm Security Program. But that was a program that was under fire, probably more than any other program, by whites, because the administrators in this area were apparently much more liberal than the administrators in some other areas, and perhaps more liberal than the president himself was or wanted them to be. But they got away with it, but were under fire from other whites for being too liberal.
You mentioned Mrs. Roosevelt. What about her relationship to the black community? How did people feel about her? We just rolled out. So, I want to talk about that day, that moment.
I can remember it well. I was in Raleigh, North Carolina, doing work on my doctoral dissertation. But I took Sunday off, and with a dear friend of mine, the late Emory Johnson, we drove to Goldsboro, North Carolina, the home of my fiancée. And we spent the afternoon with my future mother-in-law. And of course, the one thing we wanted to do was to hear the Marian Anderson concert. Emory Johnson was anxious to hear it. I was anxious to hear it. And my mother, my future mother-in-law was even more anxious, I think. And so we sat and listened with great intensity to this this great voice. But it was not just a great voice, it was a great experience. We were moved by the fact that this modest young woman had become a kind of instrument to show the world what bigotry could attempt and could not succeed in doing, namely to silence a great and golden voice. So that we were thrilled, there's no other word for it, we were thrilled when Miss Anderson was introduced and when she came out to sing and to entertain that vast audience before the Lincoln Memorial. A great deal was left to our imagination. There was no television, you see. And therefore, we could just sit there with our eyes closed and visualize the great scene that we later saw in pictures. It's an experience that I shall never forget.
Okay. Thank you. To switch subjects entirely, but the 30s, we talked about this, the 30s being a time of activism, and you know, particularly regarding the anti-lynching law, there was a lot of push for that. What was it about the times that made this such a vibrant period, even with all the misery? There was a lot of urgency in political action, labor action, the anti-lynching campaign. What was it about that?
I think that we were waking up from a long period of lethargy that was a part of the early years of the Depression. And how do you overcome? How do you get beyond this? How do you pull out of this? You pull out of it by having programs of one kind or another that will focus on the problems of the day, problems being the economy, being voting, civil rights, and political rights. And so in all these areas, you had action, activity. The labor unions were active, and of course they found in the federal government, that is under the leadership of Roosevelt, they found a very good friend who, and through him and people like Senator Wagner, you got very effective legislation. They found that that the political process was being opened up. Not only was the white primary under fire, but blacks were pressing for voting opportunities. Then you had efforts being made to protect blacks in their rights, their civil rights, and you had drives against lynching and drives in favor of anti-lynching legislation. And while these drives did not materialize in anything effective, they show a certain vitality, a certain liveliness in the area, in the period that that was itself very impressive. Then, of course, there is the swing of the pendulum from the conservatism of the 20s to the radicalism of the 30s. And the example of something that's going on, say, in the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics that might have some impact on the United States and its problems. And so you got a swing of the pendulum toward radicalism. And you had the upsurge of the Communist Party in the United States and the effort to join hands with the liberal labor movement, the liberal civil rights, racial movement, and so forth. And that added to the ferment and to the activity that one witnesses, in the, especially in the 30s and to less extent in the 40s.
Was there something about the economy that brought up this ferment? Do you think the economy had something to do with it, or was it more the government, the New Deal, and the programs?
Well, it was that the that people felt that the way in which you pulled yourself out of the economic doldrums was through government action. And that was the nexus. That was the connection between the economy on the one hand and all this activity on the other. The industrialists, the financiers, were lying down and playing dead, so to speak. And the government was the thing, was the instrument of change. And that's why you get that connection between the economy and government.
Great, thanks, Cut. Okay. Okay. So why was Mrs. Roosevelt such a friend? Why was this a great affinity?
Mrs. Roosevelt was a person of considerable sensitivity to social problems, racial problems, and the like. I think it was much more so than her husband. And I think that African Americans very early realized that. And she became a favorite person. She was one that blacks felt they could reach. And people like Walter White, on the one hand, and Mary McLeod Bethune, on the other, could get her ear. It was widely believed, and I'm sure Mrs. Bethune encouraged this, that Mrs. Roosevelt and Mrs. Bethune were very close friends. Mrs. Roosevelt moved with ease in the black community. She would go to Howard University to speak. She would go speak before the women's federations, clubs. She would visit black colleges in various parts of the country. She would attend civic meetings and interracial meetings, and therefore giving her blessing to the joint effort of blacks and whites to solve their problems together. Thus, Mrs. Roosevelt became a kind of intermediary between the administration on the one hand and the black community on the other. And there was the belief that you could reach the president through her. And I have no doubt that on occasion that did occur. So that she was widely and greatly admired. I remember so well in 1945, it turned out to be just a matter of days before the president's death that she came to Bennett College, where I was teaching a course.
Excuse me, I'm sorry, can you cut for a second? I'm sorry. I wanted-